Good morning, everybody. Hey, we're gonna start a new series today that's gonna last for quite a little while. We're gonna take a journey through 2 Corinthians, and we're gonna talk about wide open spaces. And I'm excited about this. One thing, when I look at Paul writing to the Corinthian church, he wrote two very long letters to the Corinthian church, 1 and 2 Corinthians. And the Corinthian church was an absolute mess. And he is trying to help them pull it together and live the kind of life that God has for them. And every time I read this, it helps me realize that even great leaders will have messy churches. Yeah. Amen. Turn and look at your neighbor and say, he's talking about you now. And the truth is, every church is a mess because every church is filled with people who are a mess. And we're all coming in to the house of God needing the help of God, needing the grace of God, needing the touch of God on our life. And so you're never going to find a perfect church anywhere. Matter of fact, if you found a perfect church, probably a good idea if you didn't go. Because you'd mess it up for sure, wouldn't you? And we're all in here. We're a mess, but God is lifting our lives. And what Paul is doing in 2 Corinthians is appealing to them to rise up to live the life that God has ordained for them, the life that God's planned to give them. And I love 2 Corinthians because what Paul is doing in 2 Corinthians, what the Holy Spirit is doing through Paul, is he's not fussing at this church, but he's actually appealing to them by declaring to them the promises that God has given them that allow them to lift and live a higher life. And so I'm excited to explore through the book of 2 Corinthians. I'm not going to go like every single verse in the book. I'm actually going to grab a few concepts that really speak to my own heart and my own soul. But I want to read a passage. This isn't the beginning passage, but it kind of describes why we came up with this idea of wide open spaces as the title for this series. It's out of the Message, 2 Corinthians chapter 6, and we're going to talk about it a little bit later, but it says, Dear Rock Church, I can't tell you how much I long for you to enter this wide open, spacious life. We didn't fence you in. The smallness you feel comes from within you. Your lives aren't small, but you're living them in a small way. I'm speaking as plainly as I can and with great affection. Open up your lives, live openly and expansively. That's a great passage of scripture because it gives us a concept that you find throughout the Bible that I find we need to be reminded of often. And that it's this idea. Your life is not happening to you. Your life is happening through you. I listened to this Dixie Chicks song, and I'm realizing that this girl is saying, I've got to go somewhere else to live the life that God wants me to live. But I've discovered that wherever you go, there you are. And if you like chocolate chip cookies in Asheville, you're gonna like chocolate chip cookies in Canada. If you can't get up and be at church on time in Asheville, well, you know where I'm going with that, right? And the truth is, Paul is appealing to the Corinthians throughout this entire book to say to them, the smallness that you feel, or the rejection that you feel, or the bound up that you feel, or any of the things that are happening to your life, is really coming from within you. It's not so much coming from outside of you. And there are several passages of Scripture that touch on this idea. I want to remind you of a few of them this morning. Proverbs 4:23 says this: "Watch over your heart with all diligence, for from it, from your heart, flows the springs of life," or the issues, the one translation says. And it's, one other translation even tells us the borders of your life are coming from your heart. What's going on inside of you is deciding the borders of your life. Jesus touched this a couple of times in the Gospels. Matthew chapter 12, verse 33 says, "Make the tree good, and then its fruit will be good. Or make the tree bad, and then its fruit will be bad. For the tree is known by its fruit. You brood of vipers." That'd be a way to build church, wouldn't it? "Come to church tomorrow. We're so excited. I'm going to be talking to the brood of vipers. You're welcome. You brood of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak what's good? For the mouth speaks out of that which fills the heart. The good man brings out of his good treasure that's in his heart what is good, and the evil man brings out of the evil treasure that's in his heart what is evil." Jesus also said it again, Matthew 15. He says, "The things that proceed out of the mouth come from the heart, and those defile the man. For out of the heart come evil thoughts, come murders, adulteries, fornications, thefts, false witness, slanders." So here's the concept that I think Paul is addressing the Corinthian church on, and that you and I can learn something very powerful, and that is this: whatever you fill your heart with is what your life overflows with. If you fill your heart with peace, your life will be full of peace. If you're waiting for all the circumstances around you to lend you peace, you may never find peace. If you fill your heart with love, if you fill your heart with grace, if you fill your heart with flourishing, if you fill your heart with faith, if you fill your heart with confidence, that's the kind of life you're going to live. But if you fill your heart with worry, if you fill your heart with anxiety, if you fill your heart with negativity, if you fill your heart with doubt or fear or timidity or revenge, then you are creating your life by what you fill your heart with. And it's an astonishing truth that could literally transform your life. And this is what Paul is appealing to in the Corinthian church. He's trying to get them to understand that the way you position things inside of yourself is going to make all the difference in the world in what happens in your life. You're going to come into wide open spaces when your heart begins to come into wide open spaces. So if you change your thinking, or if you change the words that come out of your mouth, if you change the way you believe about life, if you change your outlook, if you could reframe the picture to see it the way God tells us to see it, something amazing will start to happen in your life. I just want to announce to you today that you don't need anyone else's permission to be happy. That comes from within you. That's your choice. That's what you get to fill your heart with. You don't need anyone else's permission to live a blessed life, to live a flourishing life. That's what you fill your heart with. It's not your circumstances, it's your heart. or shout me down. You don't need anybody else's permission to live peacefully. You don't need anyone else's permission to love greatly. And that's what Paul is appealing to when he's telling the Corinthians, and what he would speak to us today is, you, the smallness you feel comes from within. The wide open spaces comes from within. So I want to land on the verse that I want to talk about today. That was just introduction. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20. This is the first concept that I want to talk about for this series of messages. As many as are the promises of God in Him, in Jesus, they are yes. Somebody say yes. Therefore, also through Him is our amen. Somebody say amen. Come on, that was your one chance to get practice on saying amen. To the glory of God through us. God is a God of yes. And many people try to paint God as a God of no. They want to characterize walking with God. They want to characterize a relationship with God. They want to characterize Christianity as no. Don't do this, can't do this, shouldn't do that. And I want you to know that what Paul is appealing to in the Corinthian church is really an amazing thought, an amazing piece of theology that could actually shift a lot of things for our life, is when we realize that God is not a God who builds life with us on the concept of no. He is the God who builds life with us on the concept of yes. All the promises of God are yes to you and to me in Jesus. Now, let me back this up a little bit and give us some foundation for understanding. God is a God who relates to us people in terms of covenant. He's a God of covenant. Broadly, you're going to see there's an old covenant, that's the Old Testament. There's a new covenant, that's the New Testament. So covenant is God's arrangement of how He's going to interact with us. It's His description of how He's going to be with us in life. And even within the old covenant, you would find that God made covenants. He made a covenant with Abraham. He made a covenant with Noah that he wouldn't destroy the earth through a flood. He made a covenant with David. And if you were living in the day of Abraham, if you wanted to relate to God, then you had to come into Abraham's covenant with God. If you were living in the day of Noah and you wanted to relate to God, you had to come into Noah's covenant with God. So there's like five or six different covenants that God made within the old covenant, within the Old Testament. The New Testament, God's covenant is with Jesus. So if you want to relate to God, you've got to come into a relationship with God that comes into the covenant that God has with Jesus. If we're going to have a relationship with God in these days, in New Testament days, we come into God's covenant with Jesus. When we come into Jesus, we come into God's covenant. And here's what I love about God, is you see Him making a covenant with Abraham or Noah or David or even a covenant with Jesus. God is the one who initiates covenant. In other words, God is the one who makes the first move. So the weight of covenant is actually on God, not on us. I'm glad that the weight of me having a relationship with God is not on me, because I find myself to be quite unpredictable, or maybe predictably unpredictable. Come on, Anybody know what I'm talking about? One day you feel like you're on top of the world, the next day the world's on top of you. Right? One day you're full of faith and confidence and worship, and the next day you're wondering, why the heck do I even take up space on this planet? Anybody know what I'm talking about? And the weight of a relationship with God is on God. Now, I really have prayed for some time as I'm preparing this message that the lights will come on for us today, because I think there's a piece of theology here that can actually help us live wide open spaces kind of living. And that is this idea. God's covenant with us is built on his promises to us. God's arrangement to be close to you is not dependent on your behavior. Okay, let me say that again. God's decision to be close to you is not dependent on your behavior, it's dependent on his promise. We live in an arrangement that God has made with us. And how many of you know he gets to define the arrangement? Hello, he's God, we're not. And Hebrews 8 says this, now Jesus has obtained a more excellent ministry by as much as he is also the mediator of a better covenant, a better arrangement, which has been enacted on better promises. Good behavior is a good thing, but good behavior is the result of being right with God. Good behavior does not earn God's approval or God's promise. Faith receives God's promise. And that's what the amen is. Amen literally means so be it. God says it, my faith goes, the promise is yes to me through Jesus, and then my answer back is so be it through Jesus. See, here's the beauty of the gospel. We all get in on everything God has promised to us because of what Jesus has done for us. That's the gospel. That's the good news. Jesus has done all that needs to be done for us to be right with God. Jesus has done all that needs to be done for us to receive all the good things God has planned for us. Our role is simply receive what God gives. Aren't you glad that it's not about how good you are? It's about how good God is. And I want you to get this idea that your life, the arrangement of your relationship with God and the arrangement of your relationship with life is lifted by the promise of God. 2 Peter 1 says this, seeing that his divine power, his supernatural power, has granted to us everything in the Greek means everything. Pertaining to life, everything pertaining to life and godliness, through the true knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and excellence. For by these he has granted to us his precious and magnificent promises. Everything you need for life, everything you need for godliness, has been provided by God. You and I have nothing to bring to the table but need. He has provided everything. And access to God's supernatural power comes by these precious and magnificent promises. The promise of God is the portal that God gets himself into your life. Am I preaching this okay? If you locate a promise from God and from God's word, it will give you access to God's covenant power for your life. God's word has a promise for your marriage. God's word has a promise for your health. God's word has a promise for your ministry. God's word has a promise for your kids. Somebody say, thank you, Jesus. God's word has a promise for your finances. God's word has a promise for your peace. And I'm saying to you, wherever you need God's ability at work in your life, locate a promise in the word of God that relates to that need. I literally believe that there are needs that exist in our lives for the sole purpose of teaching us how to access the goodness of God. Wide open spaces. That kind of living starts not with you trying harder. That kind of living starts with the goodness of God. That kind of living starts with the greatness of God. That kind of living starts with the promise of God. I'm saying, whatever you're facing that is disturbing your peace, whatever you're facing that seems to be hemming you in or making your life feel smaller than it should be, whatever you're facing in life, if you could find a promise in the Word of God that speaks to your soul, and then you would start praying, not just praying the problem, but praying the promise. If you'd start thinking not about how bad it is, but about how good the promise of God is, if you'd start building your approach to life from the promise of God, amazing things would start to happen in your world. I love this new covenant. I love this New Testament. I'm glad I was born now instead of in the Old Testament. Come on. No matter how bad you might feel today, this week, this season, thank God you were born in new covenant times. Here, let me give you a couple of promises in case you need a few. There's literally hundreds and hundreds of them. But I just want us to get a hold of this idea. 2 Corinthians 9, verse 8 says, God is able to make all grace abound to you, that you would always have all sufficiency in everything, and that you might have abundance for every good deed. That's a great promise. Deuteronomy 8, verse 18 says, you shall remember the Lord your God, for it is he who is giving you power to make wealth so that he could confirm his covenant, which he swore to your fathers as it is this day. Mark 11, verse 23 and 24 says, truly I say to you, this is Jesus talking, whoever says to this mountain, be taken up and cast into the sea, but doesn't doubt in his heart, believes that what he says is going to happen, it shall be granted him. Therefore, I say to you, all things which you pray and ask, believe that you have received them, they shall be granted you. And I know it's easy to start to create some kind of exclusion or some kind of clause, but could I ask you to not create exclusions and clauses on the words of Jesus? But maybe instead of adjusting the Word of God to your situation, how about adjusting your situation to the Word of God? Just a thought. John 14:12, Jesus says, truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, shall he do also greater works. Then these shall he do, because I go to the Father. Matthew 7:7, Jesus again, ask, it'll be given to you. Seek, you will find. Knock, the door shall be opened to you. Come on, that's certainty, isn't it? Mark 9:23, all things are possible to him who believes. Come on, can anybody feel the description of a wide open spaces kind of life? Thank you, 23 of you. Come on. We know Romans 8:28, that God causes all things, even your stupidity and mine, to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. I just want to point out to you, that's just 8 verses of scripture, 8 passages. And if we were to get a hold of these passages and realize that this is God saying in all of these passages to us, not no, not maybe, not kind of, not if you got your act together, not if you were smarter, not if you had a degree, not if you were in better shape, but God saying to us in Jesus, yes, here's what these promises are giving us. You would always have enough. You would have abundance to give for every good deed. You would have power to get wealth. You would move mountains rather than just talk about mountains. You would do greater works than Jesus. You would always find a way. You would always find an answer. You would always find an open door. All things would be possible to you. Everything would work out for you. Come on, that's a great life. That's a wide open spaces kind of life. And I realize that you hear this, and I don't know where you are in your journey and where you are in this season, but I know sometimes your emotions can get a hold of you and suppress you to where it's difficult to see the light that God wants to shine into your life. And I'm just saying to you, come on, God relates to you and relates to me on the basis of a covenant that is built on better promises. He is relating to you on the fact of his promise to you. In Jesus, God says yes. Yes to you. You want to live a blessed life? Yes. You want to walk in peace? Yes. You want to get free from that bitterness and revenge that's in your heart? Yes. Come on, God's giving you a green light to live in the wide open spaces. But it's all about what's going on inside of you, your heart. In Jesus, God says, yes to us. Through Jesus, we say amen. God's yes is important, but your amen is just as important. When the angel showed up to Mary, young 16-year-old Mary, and Luke chapter 1, the angel speaks to her and says, the Holy Spirit's going to come upon you. The power of the Most High is going to overshadow you. For that reason, the Holy Child is going to be called the Son of God. Behold, even your relative Elizabeth has also conceived a son in her old age. Now, she who was called barren is now, I love that phrase, you once were called one thing, now called something else. I love it. She who once was called barren is now in her sixth month, for nothing will be impossible with God. And the literal Greek translation of that phrase is, no word of God is without power. Nothing will be impossible with God. And Mary's response is, behold, the bondslave of the Lord. May it be done to me according to your word. In other words, God speaks through an angel to Mary, and Mary's response is, amen. God says yes, she says amen. God doesn't move in your world beyond your permission. Why is it that there are all these incredible promises and there are so few people actually walking in those promises? It's because we create these exclusions, we create these clauses, we create this, yeah, but if you only understood, if you just saw my situation. I'm just saying to you, he does say yes because of Jesus, not because of you. But then there is required from us an amen, a so be it. And I really believe that if God can't get permission to move in us, then he's going to look for somebody else. All the promises are yes. You know, I remember when I first gave my heart to Christ, there was this kind of thinking that be careful, don't make a move because you might get out of the will of God. And I want to tell you, it's not that confined. It's not that tight. It's wide open spaces. In other words, it's always yes. It's always a green light till you get a red light. So just assume yes. Just assume favor. Dang, I'm liking this message. Just assume the goodness of God. And when God is wanting to tell you no, he knows how. He hasn't given you a red light to sit at forever. He's given you green light after green light after green light, and occasionally there's a red light. God says, yes. God, I want to do something for you. Yes. God, I want to rise up and be the man you've called me to be. Yes. God, I want to rise up and make a difference in the earth. Yes. Our amen is our yes to God. It takes his yes and our yes. Luke 1:45, as we go on in this story, it says, blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what had been spoken to her by the Lord. I'm encouraging you to believe God, to adjust your thinking, your perspective, your attitude, to get a hold of this piece of theology that is so amazing to understand that God relates to you and me on the basis of promises. The covenant is a covenant of promises. Promises only live in the land of potential until they are actually possessed. Remember the story in the Old Testament, 1 Samuel 30. David and all of his band of men had gone out to war, and they came back and found that the Amalekites had come into town and had pillaged their entire place where they lived. Had stolen the kids, had stolen the wives, had stolen everything. And it's a picture of the enemy that loves to come in to our lives and steal. That's what he does. He likes to steal, kill, and destroy. And at first, David and all of his men came in. Their wives were gone. Their kids were gone. Their stuff was gone. Their remote for the TV was gone. Everything was gone. And it was like, hey, wait a minute. We were out doing the will of God. And his first response was to wail, to cry, to go, I can't believe this has happened to me. And you might feel that way. The enemy has come in to steal your health or steal your finances or steal your marriage or steal your kids. And here's what I love about David. He cried, he wailed, then he got up and he said, you know what? I'm going to do something about this. I'm not just going to lay down and let this be the story of my life. So 1 Samuel 30 verse 8 says this, David inquired of the Lord, should I pursue the band? Shall I overtake them? And the Lord said to him, pursue. You're surely going to overtake them. You're surely going to rescue all. I love it. The promises are yours, but you have to pursue. Every promise that God gives has to be joined with some kind of pursuit, some kind of amen. Has to be taken a hold of and say, God, I know the promise is yes in Jesus, but I'm going to say yes myself. Hebrews 4 says, indeed, we've had good news preached to us just like the Israelites, but the word they heard didn't profit them because it wasn't united by faith. It wasn't united by amen. It wasn't united by yes. I'm encouraging you today to have faith in God's heart toward you. To have faith in God's capability to do incredible things in your life. To have faith in the potential that the promise of God holds for you. I want to encourage some of us in this room have just felt like laying down and giving up and quitting. And I'm here today to say to you, thus saith the Lord. Can I use old King James English? Pursue, overtake, recover. It's always God's heart that you would walk into full restoration. It's not automatic. It happens in your pursuit. The promise of God doesn't come by your effort, but it does require your participation. As many as are the promises of God, they are yes in Jesus. Therefore, also through him is our, come on, say it with me, amen to the glory of God. Come on. Let me pray with you today. I want you to bow your heads. I want you to close your eyes. Here's your chance to say yes. I don't know what you're facing in your life, but I do know that God has a promise to bring you out, to bring you in to everything that He has for you. Come on, it's the way He relates. It's His covenant. Father, I'm praying for every person in this room as they're facing their mountain. Lord, You have a promise to speak to our soul that will allow us to apprehend the goodness of God. And I'm praying for every person here today. You will speak, Holy Spirit, and bring the life of the promise of God into our world. With your head bowed, your eyes closed, just the last few moments of this meeting, maybe you need to just say yes to Jesus. Maybe you need to open your heart for Him to come into your world and be the Lord of your life. I don't know, maybe you're here today and you have never really just surrendered to Christ. Today, I would love to pray with you. I would love to stand with you as you say yes. Maybe you're here today and you used to be closer to God than you are today. Today would be a great day for you to come home. Maybe you feel unsure about where you stand with God, but today would be a great day to open your heart and get confident. But if that's you today, you've never given your life to Christ, or maybe you've fallen away from where you used to be, or maybe you feel unsure about where you stand, and you say, Pastor, would you pray with me? I want you to lift your hand real high and just say, that's me. Nobody's looking around, but just lift your hand up and say, I'm opening my life to Christ today. I'm opening my life to the love of God. I'm opening my life to the help of God. God bless you. Is there anybody else that just would say, yes, that's me? Come on, maybe the realization has finally hit you that it's not about you being good, it's about Him being good. And that changes everything. Is there anybody else, thank you, that would just say, yeah, pray with me? Amen. Amen. Let's pray this prayer together. This is for everybody that lifted their hand, but I would like for us all to say these words together out loud. Everybody say, Lord Jesus, I open my life to Your love, to Your lordship. I need You. I want You in my world as my Lord. I know I've sinned. I come to the cross where You paid the price for my forgiveness. Today is a fresh start, a new beginning. As I receive Jesus, help me become the person You created me to be. Amen. Come on, let's thank the Lord. Amen. Beautiful. Hey, let's take a few moments and worship God. Could you stand with me, please? And let's take a few minutes to just don't leave. This is not the time to leave. This is the time to drill down, get in the presence of God.